Thank you very much. It's great to be here in New York. We'll go ahead and load up the slides and walk you through. My presentation is going to be a little different than some of the others. It's going to be more focused on emerging markets and a little bit more of a business angle. So hopefully you'll enjoy that. So I'm a member of a group called the Intel World Ahead Program, which is a program at Intel, which is focused on helping to improve the access to technology, whether it's computers, broadband, educational tools to people that don't have it today. So we have four fundamental pillars. The first is getting PCs. So we'll work very closely with governments to help improve the affordability of PCs, to make them so they're more affordable, that more people in a particular country can have those. We'll also design specific platforms, computers designed specifically for a classroom, computers designed specifically for a clinical environment, such as a mobile clinical assistant. We'll also work with the governments to help make broadband more accessible and more available to the community. So we'll work with universal services funds, work with telco operators to help drive down the price of broadband to make it more affordable. And then thirdly, in terms of our pillar around education, is many times people are seeing a PC for the very first time and don't have any idea how to work it. So we have tools such as PC Basics. We also have tools to help teachers in classrooms integrate computers into their classroom to help them with a multimedia-rich environment to help improve the education process. And then finally, once you have a device, you have connectivity, and you know how to use it, you need the right content. And that's a really, really important strategy of the content that is locally developed. It should be in the right culture, the right language, and be specific to the user. So when you combine all those four pillars of the World Ahead program, healthcare spans across all four of those, and you can find that it is a very powerful tool for improving the access to healthcare. In terms of where I focus, so I'm the director of emerging market healthcare, so I spend most of my time outside the United States in countries that are struggling with some very basic needs. And one of the areas that I work on is focused on health education. So how can you use computers to do two things? One, to help improve the medical schools and nursing schools to help them graduate with better proficiency around ICT skills, as well as just overall produce more graduate students. And second, once you've graduated and you're at a remote location, how do you stay current in your job skills? So if you're in a rural village that's 300 kilometers from the nearest county hospital, how do you stay trained? And we're going to talk more about that. The second area is around mobile health workers. So in many countries, when you go out to a clinic, there are people that actually go out into the community to capture health and demographic information. Typically, that's done on paper, pencil, in forms, and it takes months to get that data compiled, put into an electronic format, and sent back to a state or provincial level where they can make decisions. So we think there's a great opportunity to bring in computers. Here's a great example of a mobile health worker using a computer designed for education and taking data on a newborn in Bangladesh. And then the third area is around rural clinics. So again, that's where the workhorse of the healthcare systems are for many emerging markets. And so how do you improve the efficiency of that rural clinic? How do you provide tools for a doctor such as this so that they can be more efficient in how they deliver healthcare? And then finally, this is an emerging trend, which we don't see a whole lot of, but many countries are starting to look at how do you bring technology into the home to manage conditions such as cardiovascular disease, diabetes, asthma, some of those chronic conditions that are really taxing the healthcare system. And we're finding that through continua compliant devices, so again, a special third-party organization that Intel founded, you start to get these devices that are plug-and-play interoperable that can connect to a phone, can connect to a computer, and start to capture that information electronically that can be pushed into a health record. And we're seeing a lot of great progress in that space. When I go around, and again, I've probably been to about 40 countries in the last 5 years, there's three fundamental drivers no matter what country I'm in, whether it's the United States, if it's a country in Africa, or elsewhere. But typically, people are just living longer. That's great news. You know, people that were once killed with chronic conditions are living longer, but that's also putting a bigger burden on the healthcare system. Two, there's a shortage of qualified healthcare workers. So in the U.S., for 1,000 people, you might have 2 to 3 doctors taking care of that. If you go to an emerging market, say in sub-Saharan Africa, it may be 1/10 of that or even 1/100th of that. So there just aren't enough doctors and nurses in many parts of the world where the healthcare is needed to take care of those people. And then finally, the rising healthcare costs. I think in some of the earlier presentations, you heard about the cost of healthcare. In the US, we're gonna spend between 16 and 17% of our GDP on healthcare alone. And you heard it's, you know, $6,000 to $7,000 per capita. We spend a lot of money on healthcare, but yet our outcomes in terms of the average lifespan, infant mortality, maternal health, aren't the best. So clearly we're spending money, but it's not maybe directed necessarily in the right areas. So Intel, kind of looking at these three drivers, and we often refer to this as the perfect storm in terms of the aging, the shortage of workers, and the high cost, we think that there's new care models that need to be developed, as well as looking at how technology can play that role. In terms of the continuum of care, there's a slide that was shown in a video. It's very similar to this, but we tend to view on an axis here of quality of life. So the higher up you are on this particular axis, the better off you're going to be. This is the health and wellness. This is where we all aspire to be. The cost of care for us that are healthy is very, very low, and we enjoy a good quality of life. As you start to shift down towards this direction, not so good. So down here is in the acute care setting. Again, very, very expensive. Quality of life is very, very low. And typically, you want to work your way or essentially shift left up this continuum of care. And what Intel as a technology tends to look at is how can we bring technology across this continuum of care to help improve that, to get you up to that next level so that you're not stuck in a hospital or in a residential home, or that you can have a device that sit in the home to help manage your care versus having to go to a clinic three times a day or three times a week to get your blood pressure checked. So again, technology playing a key role. And here's a device that Intel put together 4 or 5 years ago called the Intel Health Guide. It's now marketed and sold with a new company called Care Innovations that's owned 50% by Intel and GE Healthcare. So our strategy is using technology along this continuum of care to help improve life. As I mentioned, my focus is really starting to look at, outside the mature markets at the emerging markets, and one of the fundamental problems that I see is just the shortage of workers. So again, here you can see in sub-Saharan Africa, Peru, Central America, Southeast Asia, South Asia, there's just not enough workers. There's a fundamental shortage of doctors, nurses, midwives, and how do you do that? You can graduate more students, or do you look and see how do you make them more efficient? And that's Intel's approach in terms of doing both. All right, so let's talk about India. So one of the things that when you look at India, they have the most medical schools and nursing schools of any country in the world. They produce more doctors and nurses, yet they have a fundamental shortage of workers. They have 75% of their doctors are taking care of 25% of the population that sits in the city. So when you start to look at the population and the rural environment, they simply don't have enough doctors. So how can you use technology to reach out into some of those communities to help out? And one of the projects we worked on was to basically bring in telemedicine to allow, actually this is for the education program, to basically find ways to improve the throughput of those educational schools. So instead of having some of your traditional content be taught by a professor in a classroom, can you shift some of that learning to an online environment so that you basically free up the brick and mortar schools to graduate more doctors and nurses? And so this is a great example of taking multimedia-rich content. So again, this is content that's developed in local language from experts throughout India and beyond, and bringing the best-of-breed content and providing that content to help educate some of those undergraduate courses in medical school so that the professors in the brick-and-mortar schools have more time to teach some of the hands-on skill sets. So a great example of using technology to kind of increase the pipe, if you will, of that school so that more doctors and nurses can be graduated. Here's a great example of another project. So again, in Nigeria, a fundamental problem that the Ministry of Health was struggling with is we have 800 communities or villages that simply don't have access to healthcare. One of the options on the table is we can go out and build about 250 primary care clinics, staff them with doctors and nurses we don't have today, and provide the traditional medicine that we are doing for many of the residents. Or is there another option? So that's where Intel came in and said, let's hold a workshop, let's get the smartest minds around the table and see if there's an option. And what they came up with was pretty brilliant, I thought, is equipping four-wheel drive trucks with a doctor, a nurse, a midwife, a social worker, and a driver actually go out into the communities, staff the trucks with medical diagnostic equipment, with medicines and vaccines, And what we found is by doing this, and here's a great example of a rural clinic that's been set up. You can see it's outdoors. But we used purpose-built, ruggedized computers to capture the information. We use this open source software called DHIS. It's currently used in about 12 countries in Africa to capture some of that health information. So now you start to get a little bit smarter about where you deploy resources. So when the trucks come back and get connectivity, they upload this information. And if you're working in a state and trying to decide where do I put my limited resources for malaria, HIV, and tuberculosis, you now have data to make smart decisions. And so with this, there were a couple good things. One, the people received care. So those 800 villages typically hadn't seen any health care at all, now had access to health care. And the detection of some of the diseases, such as malaria and HIV, went up by ninefold. So incredible effort to start to pick out some of those pain points, as well as start to make very, very good decisions about how to use those healthcare dollars. This is Dr. Wu in the Hunan province. I got to meet him about 3 years ago. So it's about 2 hours from the nearest county hospital. It's a one-room clinic. Here you can see what amazed me as I walked in to this clinic. You have a smart card reader. Missed it over here. There's a modem. He's got a netbook. And then that's the cabin of medicines that he distributes. And Dr. Wu was not a real proponent of technology. But when the Ministry of Health came in, the Hunan province said, we're going to provide you a computer. And the first application we're going to put on there is billing software. And what did that allow that doctor to do? He got paid a lot, lot quicker. So this type of technology now he's embracing. And we're going to put additional tools, telemedicine. You've seen some previous discussions around clinical decision support. So making a doctor like Dr. Wu, who has eighth grade education, 6 months of medical training, so kind of a bona fide EMT, now he's got some skills and some tools to be more effective in providing care for about 3,000 people in his village. So it amazed me. One other interesting point about this is when I looked at the clinics, there's close to 500,000 to 700,000 clinics in China. About two-thirds of them have broadband, which blew me away. Again, this is a dirt road to this clinic. They have power, but two-thirds of the clinics have affordable broadband. He pays about $10 a month for his broadband, which is unbelievable. And then this is the one that I was starting to talk about earlier in terms of the cardiac screening. So again, going back to India, where we have a shortage of qualified professionals in the rural community, how do you start to do some basic screening? And so what they found is, typically, if a person has a potential heart condition, they had traveled 2 to 4 hours to a county hospital, meet with a cardiologist, have an ECG, and from there get a reading that says, oh, you're okay, then you can go home. And what they were able to do through technology, through a computer and a portable ECG machine, was basically hook up and do a diagnostic in 6 minutes and send that data over to a cardiologist at a regional cardiac center to determine and read that particular data and provide a report to determine if further intervention was necessary. So rather than going from hours or days to get your heart checked, it went down to 6 minutes. The cost was reduced by 90%, so an incredible savings in terms of just that overall cost. And they were able to screen tens of thousands of patients in a very short period of time, and they found between 30 and 50 patients that required follow-up in a very, very affordable and sustainable way. And then lastly, I'd like to talk about an initiative that Intel announced in here in New York in September. So again, for UN Week, which is a week when everybody from all the different nations come together to convene, we decided as Intel that it was important to do something from the private sector. And that's where we decided to make a commitment to help governments train 1 million workers by 2015. So on one of the previous slides, you saw where we helped train 10 million teachers in the classroom. We're going to use that train-the-trainer model. We're going to use technology to help train 1 million midwives, nurses, and doctors with in-country programs. There's no shortage of money. When you look at the $40 billion between the NGO communities, the governments, the private sector, there's tons of money flowing in, but it's focusing it into the right areas. And we think health education will have a big impact to do that. Countries are struggling with Millennium Development Goals. So if you know, number 4 is about infant mortality, ages 0 through 5. Number 5 is around maternal health. So how do women survive delivering a baby? And 6 is around HIV, AIDS, and malaria. So we think that by bringing in technology, focusing this investment, and helping to train those workers that are out in those rural communities that are taking care of a lot of people, that you're going to see better outcomes. You're going to see births that are actually attended. You're going to see vaccinations given in counseling around nutrition. And just that some very basic things that we would think of here in the United States, but in other places, even though it's common sense, not necessarily common practice. And that's where we are really proud of this commitment to help work with countries to help train those million workers. One of the things we're going to do is develop a platform. So again, we think it's important to have an affordable computer. You're going to have an affordable broadband. And we're going to put a platform that basically allows third-party content, educational content, to land on that platform so that governments can take the best of breed content in the right language, in the right culture, for their specific challenges, and allow them to start to educate their workers. So a midwife can receive training on delivering births, prenatal care, and just very, very, like I said, very, very basic things, but the type of training that's needed, and it's needed from an ongoing basis. And we're going to provide that platform for free. Intel recognizes that we're not the experts in healthcare, nor do we have a bunch of content. So that's where we're going to rely heavily on public-private partnerships to bring that content in and have that disseminated out. So again, a computer, a broadband, a framework, and that content plugging in will have a powerful, powerful impact, I think, on those workers that are in shortage and really are looking for tools to do a better job. So lastly, ICT, information and communication technology, it can play a huge role in improving the access to healthcare. And it's not only in the urban areas and the hospitals and some of the large hospital systems that have EMR records, but it goes down to the rural clinics where maybe it's just a basic PC with a few tools to have that doctor, nurse, or midwife do a better job. And we think that bringing technology can both improve the citizens in the cities as well as in the rural environments. And second, depending on the economics, every place I go to, you need to have a very healthy nation. You need to have a well-trained workforce. And we think education can play a key role in that. And then lastly, I'd like to leave with that, Intel's a big company. We're 100,000 people. We have excellent products, but we can't do it all alone. So we're going to rely very heavily on public-private partnerships. To me, that's the key. When the public sector and the private sector can sit down, take the best-of-breed solutions, the strengths, and put together a team to tackle a simple problem or a tough problem, that's where you start to see the power. That's where you're going to see the innovation and the sustainability take off. So with that, I look out on the room here, and this is one of the best academic institutions in the country. You've got a great medical school, engineering school, public health. So you guys are the future leaders. And so I'd ask you to be inspired, create change, and start now. Thank you very much.